Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our October Benedictine conversation, which is entitled Finding Joy, a Balanced Practice. I'm Dawn Carrillo. I'll be your host this evening, and I just want to welcome you all here to this space, to this conversation, as we delve this year more deeply into the practice of joy. We'll run this Benedictine conversation just like other ones in the past, if you've joined us before, where we'll have some conversation between the guest and me. If at any time you want to make a comment or if you have a question, please feel free to send it in by chat. And I will remind you about that later on in the evening. The best view for you all out there tonight would be the speaker view. So I would encourage you in the top right corner of your Zoom screen to change that to a speaker view. And now I want to introduce our guest for the evening. Tonight we are very joyful to welcome Barbara McDonald here with us. Barbara comes to us with a wealth of experience in the field of education, both as an educator, as an administrator. And she grew up in Lebanon and has lived and worked all over the world, really. Asia, Europe, Middle East, Asia. Maybe we'll hear more about that later in the conversation. And she is currently the 13th president of the College of St. Scholastica, which she started this position in 2019, August of 2019, the August before the pandemic hit. So she has had a very full few years as the college president. But in this very short time, even with the pandemic, in the middle of it all, Barbara has become very loved and highly valued and regarded by the Sisters of St. Scholastica and really the entire Scholastica community. So Barbara, I just want to welcome you here with us tonight.
Well, thank you so much, Donna. It's actually my joy to be here. So I'm really happy to be here in conversation with you this evening and look forward to our talk.
Wonderful. And I love your background. This is actually the cloister walk, isn't it?
It is the cloister walk. And it's one of my favorite Zoom backgrounds that I use pretty regularly. During the pandemic, people were wondering whether the people behind me actually were not masked and why. And so it was a conversation starter too, but really to center ourselves and thinking about our history and heritage and our legacy. Mm-hmm. This is one of my favorite backgrounds to center myself.
Beautiful. Thanks for sharing that. That's lovely. Thank you. I'd like to start this evening with a little opening kind of meditative reading. And I actually came across this little passage I'm going to read. I thought of you when I read it because I'm fascinated by how your living all over the world has possibly affected your life and how you see the world. And I know we're going to be talking about that shortly, particularly as it relates to this concept of joy. But first I want to read this. And this is a passage from the Dalai Lama and his interviewer, Douglas Abrams, in this beautiful book that I know many of the sisters have been reading, The Book of Joy. And I think when you hear this passage, you'll probably be able to figure out why I thought of you. So it begins with a quote by the Dalai Lama. He says, for every event in life, there are many different angles. When you look at the same event from a wider perspective, your sense of worry and anxiety reduces and you have greater joy. And that's the end of his quote. And his interviewer goes on to say, while changing our emotions is quite hard, changing our perspective is actually relatively easy. It is a part of our mind over which we have influence. The way you see the world, the meaning you give to what you witness, changes the way you feel. It can be the first step of a spiritual and neural journey that results in more and more equanimity and of our default state being increasingly more joyful. Perspective is nothing less than the skull key that opens all of the locks that imprison our happiness. And more on that a little later, but I'd like to begin our conversation this evening just hearing from you, Barbara. Wondering if you could start by just telling us a little bit about your life and how you ended up here in Duluth.
Okay, that's a good question. And again, thank you, Don, for having me on tonight, and welcome to everyone who's tuned in to tonight's session. First and foremost, I want to say that I'm not an expert in joy. I don't think any of us really are. Fundamentally, it's a lifelong journey, I think, and I'll share some perspective around that a bit later as Don continues our conversation with me. So I'll start a little bit about my life. I'm one of seven children, born of parents that originate from Minnesota. So my mother was from International Falls, and my father was from Winona. They met sort of accidentally on a blind date when my mother was in nursing school. Now, her family couldn't afford to send her to college, and so she actually was part of what was called back then the cadet nursing program at the Fairview Hospital in Minneapolis. It was a war program right after World War II, towards the end of World War II, that they had started this training program at hospitals. And so anyway, they met on a blind date. And I think the story goes that the first date my dad had with her, he said he was going to marry her. Mm-hmm. And she said, over my dead body, I will never marry you. And what do you know, 6 months later, they got married. So, and it was interesting because my father was first generation. And so he is the youngest of five, an immigrant family from Germany and Ireland. My mother was first generation American, actually, both her parents were born in Norway. And so very much sort of the immigrant story for both my mother and my father's families. And as a first generation student at the University of Minnesota and the last in his family, the only way he could afford to go to university was because he was on the GI Bill, having served at the very end of World War II. I don't think he ever left the country. I think he was stationed in Texas. At any rate, so he graduates from the university, they're married, and a year or two later, my mother's expecting my brother, and they have no money, really, no income, and so my dad decides to answer an ad that was on the bulletin board at the university. He and a couple of his friends actually saw the advertisement for jobs, and they took it off the board because they didn't want anybody else to apply. So they applied for these positions in Saudi Arabia, actually, to go to Saudi Arabia to help with a pipeline that was being built from the eastern province across northern Saudi Arabia through Jordan, actually through the Golan Heights in Israel, and then into southern Lebanon to pump the oil from the eastern province, which is where they had found probably a decade before the largest oil reserve in the world. And so he went over to do this two-year contract, and my mother followed, living a very pioneering life at these, they lived on a pump station with probably two blocks of cinder block homes in the middle of the desert. And he actually ended up staying for his entire career for the Trans-Arabian Pipeline and later for Aramco in Saudi Arabia. And so as a result, the rest of the children, so my brother born in the U.S., the rest of us, all six girls, were all born in either Arabia or in Lebanon. And so I grew up in Lebanon, in Beirut, graduated from high school, and actually came to St. Scholastica for my first and second year of education at college. And that was my first encounter with the college. Had a wonderful experience. Thought I was going to become a nurse, and that wasn't my destiny, as I found out, and ended up transferring to a different institution and finishing up my degree in English literature and French, and went back overseas shortly after graduating to get my master's degree at the American University in Cairo. Mind you, my family was still living in the Middle East, so I was sort of essentially returning home to that part of the world. Finished my master's. My husband joined me. He wasn't my husband then, but he joined me in Cairo, and we ended up getting married there and having our first child there. And he began working after his master's degree for international news agency. And it took us on the road, both myself with my master's in English as a second language and his master's and his work in journalism took us to many different countries. I have four children, a daughter and three sons, and each of them were also born in different countries. So kind of the strange background. My husband was also born and raised in Saudi Arabia. His father actually worked for the same company my dad ended up working for, but we never met until we were in college. I tell that story because I wonder if St. Scholastica had this in mind for me all along. So we'll see. So how did I end up in Duluth? We came back to the U.S. in 1997, came back to Minnesota and decided to stay up north. My father had bought a cabin in 1958 on Rainy Lake, still in the family. And so we chose to spend a year there, which turned into 3 years. And I started working for the Minnesota State System in higher education at Rainy River Community College in International Falls. Went back to school, got my doctoral degree at the University of Minnesota, moved into administration, worked for the Northeast Higher Education District, now called Minnesota North College, for about 17 years. And then this position came up, and it was a number of different circumstances that led me to this calling, and here I am. So that's kind of how that happened, back in northern Minnesota. Previous to this position, I was serving a presidency in the Twin Cities, and that was my last position with the Minnesota State System before I joined St. Scholastica. So very happy to be here.
Wow.
long story, but
no, that's
a
little amazing
bit about my life.
I feel like St. Scholastica really did have this in mind for you all along.
I think so. I kept intersecting with a college over the years. We lived in Grand Rapids for 15 years, and my boys played soccer, and we were often here, actually.
Oh, my God.
In and out of, and then articulation agreements, and St. Scholastica actually had an office on the campus in Grand Rapids, and we actually had a very strong relationship with St. Scholastica in business and nursing. So it's been kind of in and out of my life.
Wow.
So I guess God had a plan for me to come back to St. Scholastica.
I think so. Thanks for sharing that, Barbara. That is fascinating. You know, in that opening meditation, I read that the Dalai Lama, he spoke about, as do so many of our great mystics, talk about widening and enlarging our perspective as almost a prerequisite to being happy, you know, to quit looking at me and you, but to look at we and us, you know, it's a different paradigm. And they talk in this book, the Book of Joy, about joy being a byproduct of this enlarging of perspective. And so I'm curious, how would you say living in other countries, how has that affected you in terms of enlarging your perspective and how you understand the world?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. And again, I think it's through my observations maybe that I can share some of that. So we primarily lived in developing countries. And you know, and then in addition to that, we lived in a war zone. So that when I graduated from high school, the war broke out the year that I graduated from high school. So it was a very difficult year because this was my hometown, my home city. And to see what was happening and unfolding was quite scary and tragic at the time. And we had had some other difficulties. I was evacuated during the Six-Day War. I worked at a hospital as a candy striper back in the day when I was in junior high school and ninth grade. And a lot of the victims of the war and the conflicts in Syria, particularly children, ended up in that hospital. So, you know, and I witnessed a lot of the those children that had some very serious injuries and were separated from their parents and whatnot at a pretty young age, in my case. So it was just for me interesting to see the deep, you know, people who are living in really, really dire circumstances, people living in really severe poverty. Mm-hmm. Children in Cairo, for instance, there was, and in the Philippines, we lived in Manila, people talked about the value of life and what it really meant, particularly, you know, as you saw what were referred to as street children. These are children with no homes and no families that were begging all the time in the streets, you know, because that's the way they made their living. And or families in the Philippines, for example, that lived along in shanties along the railroad tracks and in one cardboard houses and whatnot. And through all of that, despite all of that, it was really amazing to see the joy that they had in their lives. And so that was always sort of a paradox to me, because an object poverty, not having much at all, I saw some of the most beautiful things happen between families, amongst children, how they enjoyed themselves with practically nothing, but very, very joyful and their approach to many different things. And to me, I think that is very, I found that, I think I gained a lot of reward from being able to have those observations of, you know, seeing how joy is manifested even in the worst of circumstances. So to me, that's a really important thing for me to keep in mind and to remember, especially when, you know, particularly in the last years, you know, has been so challenging the last couple of years for nearly everyone. You know, people have experienced severe isolation and loneliness and mental health issues have skyrocketed. And it's just, for me, it gives me some perspective to know that people are not alone in that. You know, everyone has experienced, I think, difficulties in the last couple of years and a lot of loss. And it's, to me, it's like, okay, how do we find some joy from that or some purpose from that? What do we learn from this? Well, for one thing, we can't take anything for granted anymore.
Right.
Those of us who have been unable to see family members or unable to get together with our loved ones, we found different ways to do that via Zoom and so on, but we never take these things for granted anymore, the ability to come together, to be in community and so on. So, so anyway, living abroad really helped me broaden my perspective on that. But also on top of that, just the multiple ways in which one can look at an issue, right? The multiple perspectives of how you solve for problems, and really understanding that that humility and that, you know, we don't have all the answers. You know, we're, even though we're a developed nation and all, probably the richest nation in the world, there are nations and peoples across the world that have found a lot of the answers, much better answers than we have to solve problems.
Yeah,
certainly, and you know, around sustainability, for example. So,
so I thought it's so interesting in this book, the part where I took that passage from the Dalai Lama goes on to talk about how each problem that arises, you should look at it from six different angles, he says. And it's really interesting too, how he said that affects our anxiety and our nervousness when we're not bottled up in our one little vision, when we can widen that out.
Right.
And I'm thinking about you and that wealth of perspective you bring with you, and I'm sure it's been very valuable to those that you work with, to your family, during the pandemic. But I'm wondering how bringing those perspectives with you and that wider view of the world has affected your work as a college president.
Yeah, I think I think a lot about Saint Benedict and listening with the ear of your heart, which and then attending to those things, right? And so I think one of the practices in balancing out perspective is to really be open to the other way of thinking, and not to presume that there is just one way to approach an issue, and what we can learn from multiple cultures and how they problem solved around different issues. Mm-hmm. I remember we were in Tibet, and talk about it was the early days when they were just allowing visitors into Tibet, and I was just in very, very, very poor country as well, and we were visiting there as a group of educators, and our children were with us, and we were in the capital, and we had gone to visit some of the temples. The practice in Tibet among the monks was and the people. Was to take a journey six times a day around the perimeter of a temple, and they would carry their prayer wheels with them. And so we were at the temple when this practice was going on, and this woman came up to me and just held me. And I didn't understand their language, but she found me, and she blessed me, and she held me, and in the deepest, kindest, most loving, joyful eyes. And this woman must have been probably in her 80s or so on, but she had nothing really on her except her clothing and her prayer wheel. And it was just quite remarkable to see that. But back to the ingenuity, we were visiting another a very remote monastery, and the ingenuity of how they utilize solar heat and panels to set up their heating systems for their coffee pots and other things that they were cooking with. And I thought, gee, we need to do this too. So again, it's how does that impact my work, is being open really to thinking about multiple ways in which you might solve an issue. You know, that creativity, that wonder, that you'd gain from really leaning into other cultures allows you to do that, to open up to other perspectives.
Wow. Yeah, it's all very, very fascinating. When I think about, the perspectives you'd gained and brought with you. You titled tonight's conversation, Finding Joy, A Balanced Perspective. And I'm wondering if you could just kind of talk to us a little bit about how you understand joy. What does joy mean for you?
Thank you for that, Dawn. I'm gonna turn to my roots for just a second and talk about many of you know this person, Khalil Gibran, who wrote a book called The Prophet, and he was Lebanese. He was a Lebanese author, poet, and philosopher. He was born in 1883 and lived until 1931. He actually came to the U.S. Later in his life. And I had remembered, Don, when we were talking earlier, that he was incredibly influential in my life. He's written many essays. He's written essays on marriage and children and all sorts of things. But he also wrote an essay on joy and sorrow. And so I'm gonna read that, if you don't mind. Center us in these.
Please.
So this is what he wrote. Then a woman said, speak to us of joy and sorrow. And he answered, your joy is your sorrow unmasked. And the self same well from which your laughter rises was oftentimes filled with your tears. And how else can it be? The deeper that sorrow carves into your being, the more joy you can contain. Is not the cup that holds your wine the very cup that was burned in the potter's oven? And is not the lute that soothes your spirit the very wood that was hollowed with knives? When you are joyous, look deep into your heart, and you shall find it is only that which has given you sorrow that has given you joy. When you are sorrowful, look again in your heart, and you will see that in truth you are weeping for that which has been your delight. Some of you say, joy is greater than sorrow, and others say, nay, sorrow is greater than joy. But I say to you, they are inseparable. Together they come, and when one sits alone with you at your board, remember the other is asleep upon your bed. Verily, you are suspended like scales between your sorrow and your joy. Only when you are empty are you at standstill and balanced. When the treasure keeper lifts you to weigh his gold and his silver, needs must your joy or your sorrow rise or fall. So, you know, I share that because I remembered that I had read this a long time ago, and I had read it at different stages of my life. And that balance, and this is why a balanced practice, to me really involves understanding that in the deepest tragedy or the deepest sorrow, our joy comes from that. And I think about some of those most profound moments, which usually have involved the death of a very close loved one, how eventually we find joy in that. I'll use my dad as an example. My father passed away at a pretty young age. He was 64 years old. And I was pregnant with my last child. And that was hard for me because I was very pregnant and he was dying and I was giving birth. And I sat with him in his last day or a day and a half visiting with him. And, you know, we shared a lot of things when he was lucid enough to have a conversation, but I was so filled with sorrow about the passing, you know, that about eventuality, what was going to happen. And at the same time, I felt guilty because I was, you know, I was going to have a baby. I was going to give birth to what my youngest, which Philip John named after my dad. And so, you know, in that moment of death, which was so interesting, as we circled his bed and he was very close to the end, he lifted himself out of bed, and in front of him, there was a crucifix on the wall right in front of him. And he lit up with such joy and happiness. We were saying the Lord's Prayer at the time. And I thought, what is this thing? You know, here we are in the worst moment of our lives with my father passing away. And yet he is demonstrating some joy that he sees. You know, of course, he wasn't able to talk to us at the time. So, you know, and I remembered that. And when Philip was born, you know, I felt this tremendous joy, obviously, birthing my son, but also that my dad was with me and that I could feel him being there. And that continues to happen, even though it's been 30 plus years since he walked on this earth. He still is with us. I still feel him in moments of joy, you know, when I see signs that I know are connected with him somehow. So I think, you know, it's that. So I want to get a little bit more practical though with you, Don, too, and talk a little bit about, you know, so how do we do this every day? Because I think it's very, very difficult in the current environment that we're in. Is it really post-COVID? I don't know. But, you know, having just gone through this tremendous time where people are still recovering and mental health is still a major issue. Our world is very polarized. There's a lot of conflict. There's the war in Ukraine, you know, the poverty, the climate change issues that are really forcing large populations of people to really suffer greatly, these kinds of things. You know, how do you reconcile all that in your daily life?
Right.
And how do you find joy? You know, one thing I know is that I have to fill my cup with that ability to see the good in things. And I think, you know, I was thinking about this, about, you know, how do you get to that place where you can clear your mind and really think about, you know, the good things, what you're grateful for. And for me, it's all about making sure that you are intentional about practicing that opportunity whenever you can. For me, it's getting outside. If I connect with nature, if I can go, you know, go for a walk, if I can, you know, spend some time in meditation or prayer, just really visibly seeing the wonderful natural world that God has given us, and being able to really embrace that and clear my mind. That's where I go to find joy. And it's a practice that you have to do, because, you know, it's very easy not to do. You can work and caught up in all sorts of things. This idea of really, you know, finding yourself really being present in the moment and leaning into the things that give you joy and making space for them. We mentioned earlier that we can't take these things for granted.
Mm-hmm. And,
you know, I think for me, it's really making sure I remember that, you know, spending time with family, carving out time to be at the lake or be someplace in nature where I can find that peace of mind, brings me joy and helps me reconnect. I think people talk about making a joy list. And you can do that. You can just be very intentional about, you know, what brings me happiness and what makes me, you know, feel more balanced in my life.
Sure.
You can certainly do that. I think that works for some people. I think others talk about making sure that you surround yourself with, you know, positive energy and positive people. So there are decisions you can make.
Yeah.
To allow yourself to encounter joy more frequently. And also a big piece for me is just the ability to be in prayer and be in a meditative state where I can really reflect on, you know, the common good. That's why we're in education. We really talk about what is our purpose? You know, why are we here? And of course, if you're an educator, the best thing to do for joy is just go hang out with the students.
Well, I was going to say, so if Sally Brown, who let's pretend is a sophomore at the College of St. Scholastica, walked up to you tomorrow and said, Dr. McDonald, I heard that you were on Zoom last night and did some kind of program on Zoom, and I'm just kind of wondering, what exactly is joy?
Mm-hmm.
How would you answer Sally in two or three sentences? Yeah.
I think it's a profound feeling of a combination for me anyway, of happiness and serenity and connectedness.
Mm-hmm.
I think those are the things that I find, and in the moment. So again, when I think about Khalil Gibran's poem or musings, you know, where there is sorrow, there is joy.
Yeah.
But where there's joy, there can also be sorrow. So I think I wouldn't lay that on a student, but I would say to the student, you know, sometimes in the most profound states that you're in, there is a light that you see. There's a light that you find.
Well, that line in what you read to us where he said something about when you are experiencing deep, deep sorrow, remember joy is sleeping next to you.
Yeah, that's a wonderful way to
think. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It is, yeah. So I want to go back for a minute to the practices that you were talking about. And interestingly enough, you know, with my work in spirituality, you know, 99 times out of 100, when you ask a group of people where they've experienced their most profound experience of God, they'll say nature.
Yeah.
You know, and maybe that's what joy is that deep rooted experience of God that just kind of fills us up. We don't always have that name to put on it, but so do you utilize the Duluth trails, or do you just
that has been a thing. We also have a path up north we call the Loop, which is outdoors. It's a walking trail. So walking trails for me are really good. I love, love, love walking down at the lake here in Duluth. Mm-hmm. The lake walk is one of my most favorite places at all time. Yeah. I have a whole camera full of pictures I can show you. The other thing that is kind of interesting is that, you know, and this is particular to my family a little bit maybe, but I probably have thousands of pictures of sunsets, thousands of pictures of sunrises, because that is something about the spectacular pic, you know, that is a painting from God. That spectacular beauty, which is never repeated the same. That's why we keep taking pictures of beautiful sunsets, right? Because everyone is different. Really puts into perspective, you know, that rising of the sun, the setting of the sun, and the circle of life, frankly. And you're right. I think in nature is where I make those connections often. You have to be pretty quiet and intentional. So, you know, a lot of people walk with earbuds on and they listen to music and pot. I can't do that. I really need to be really focused on my surroundings and take it in. Because you miss things otherwise, in my book. I know it's also utilitarian to listen to a podcast while you're walking because you're able to check two things off the list.
That's an American efficiency, right?
Right. But I think you miss the point.
I agree.
Take that time. So for me, that's a big piece of that intersection.
Is there other practices? You said something about the meditation. Do you have a meditation practice, or is that mainly with your being in nature?
Mainly with my walking. For, you know, a couple of years. So I learned some of this because me and my tribe of sisters decided to get involved with Team in Training, which is an organization that raises money for leukemia and lymphoma research. And so I have a sister that works at the University of Minnesota Cancer Center in this field of protocols, you know, leukemia and lymphoma research and trials. And usually we're talking now about the people who are now at the end of the road, and this is their only option left. You know? And so I learned a lot from her, from my sister, about why she's in the work she's in. And she described it as bringing her the most joy she's ever felt, because her patients are happy, completely happy to be in the trial, to be have this opportunity and so on, even though the circumstances are so dire. So we got really engaged with a team in training. Well, this required us to walk marathons, to raise money and to walk marathons. And to walk a marathon, you have to practice. So this is how it started for me was, you know, besides I used to run many years ago and that was all good and well, but when you're walking and training for a marathon, you have to get out and walk, you know, on a schedule. You know, you might start 3 miles and then 5 and then 8 and then 10 and then 12, and then you're working up to walking 22 miles, and you can do that more than once before you prepare, as you're preparing for this marathon.
Very similar to
your running schedule. That took me outdoors. It took me on lots and lots and lots of very, very long walks in nature. And that's that's how this started for me.
And wow.
We did three of them. We did a couple other things too to raise money for that cause. But
that was going to be my next question. Are you still doing those marathons?
No, I haven't done one in a while, but I'm determined to get back at it. So this is one of my commitments that I'm trying to. My sister, the same sister, actually wants to go on a pilgrimage next summer. There's a Catholic church in Minneapolis, St. Olaf, is looking into a pilgrimage, and it's a walk, a long walk across the northern part of Norway where St. Olaf had done his missionary work. And so we're thinking about that. That will require getting into training again.
Yes.
We'll see if that happens, but
you spoke quite profoundly, eloquently about, what we've all been facing in the last 2.5 years. Mm-hmm. I have read an article in the New York Times not long ago that was saying that the two greatest challenges that our society is facing today are climate change and mental health.
Yeah, absolutely.
Change and mental health. And I think a lot of that has come about because of the intensity of the past 2.5 years. And, many of us were glued to the screen for hopeful news about the pandemic. And yet all this other stuff started coming in. Climate change is now a household conversation when it felt like before the pandemic, it wasn't in every household. But anyway, so I'm wondering, as you have fielded these last 2.5 years yourself, Barbara, mm-hmm. you've talked about, the joy that being out in nature brings you. What else has brought you joy in these last couple of years?
Well, I'm a grandmother now. So that's I think too, I have to say that the work, for me, witnessing the dedication and the commitment and the spirit of my colleagues, of the faculty staff at the college, has been nothing short of inspirational to me. When you think about what had to happen for us to continue to live our mission and to deliver our mission of education when everything went virtual, it really was quite miraculous in some ways that people found the wherewithal to do the work that was necessary so our students could continue on. I mentioned to you, Dawn, that I remember the day, was the moment when we made that decision that we had to go virtual, we had to send our students home. And the main light in my life in that moment of decision were the Benedictine values and knowing that those values were going to see us through. Particularly the value of community and how we work together as a community during that time. I'll use one example. Our former CIO, Chief Information Officer, he was just running all over Minnesota, delivering hotspots to students and to faculty and staff so they can get, a lot of our students and faculty and staff are living in remote areas in greater Minnesota. Mm-hmm. And, just that alone was, and he was so excited. he was so brave too, because he's out, at a time when nobody was supposed to be out. I mean, educators got a pass, but as the police did and other groups of people that needed to be out as essential workers. But, to watch people come together and do that hard work and not give up and be committed to the mission, be committed to our values was really inspirational to me. It was, so that was amazing. I think the fact that the pandemic, we all thought it was going to be over in 2 weeks, right? And it wasn't. And I think the more difficult thing was how do you lift people up, when there is no end in sight, And when the numbers are climbing and the death toll is climbing, and there's a great environment of fear, right?
Yeah.
How do you continue to help people along? And I think we did a pretty good job, but I would say that there was definitely a lasting impact. And I think we're still living through the trauma, frankly,
that I think so too. Yeah.
That people have felt. And we're very mindful of that. We know that mental health component is still pretty fragile. I think our students are incredibly resilient. And mm-hmm. so what was also kind of a joy for me was when the students came back, and I was really concerned about how they were doing. And, you know, they said, "We're doing great." And I'm like, "You are?" I said, "Yeah, I'm really happy to be back." And I thought, well, you're doing better than a lot of us. But they were pretty remarkable. And again, that remembrance for me, you know, these students are so resilient. I can learn so much from
yeah.
them. And
how does it feel now? You know, when did they all come back?
Incrementally.
Incrementally, that's what I thought.
Yeah, so last spring, so we're in the fall semester,
right.
Students were back. We had a lot of issues with our student athletes trying to get their seasons in. Not all students chose to come back. And, you know, we were slowly coming back face to face, and we're fully back now, you know, in the community, and it feels great.
Wow.
Everyone is really happy to be back. We're still incredibly mindful of the fact that this isn't behind us,
mm-hmm.
but we feel a lot more confident that we have the tools
mm-hmm.
necessary to battle it out, you know.
Right.
So I think for us, it's again, not taking for granted.
Yeah.
That's what I see. People are spending just a little bit more time saying hello.
I hope that stays.
Yeah.
I really hope that stays. I just want to take 1 minute here to ask all of those out there who are viewing to please send in a question or comment for Barbara by chat. I'm sure she'd love to hear from you. So go ahead and send them in, and then I will read them to her. One thing I wanted to ask you about, Barbara, that I've been aware of with myself throughout the last couple of years. Well, actually, there's this quote from Archbishop Desmond Tutu that kind of brought it to light for me. Here's what he said. "Discovering more joy does not, I'm sorry to say, save us from the inevitability of hardship and heartbreak. In fact, we may cry more easily, but we will laugh more easily too. Perhaps we're just more alive. Yet as we discover more joy, we can face suffering in a way that ennobles rather than embitters. We have hardship without becoming hard. We have heartbreak without being broken." That quote just really grabbed me, because that's something that I've noticed in myself through the past 2.5 years, is that I'm more prone to tears, and like you've been talking about, we're more mindful. Like when I can get together, I'm immunocompromised, so when I can get together with my whole family because they all take COVID tests and we're all good, it's like, you know, it just is so wonderful, and the joy in my heart is big. So I'm curious about you. I'm wondering what you've noticed about yourself. What changes, if any?
You know, I think that, well, I had a personal experience with this, speaking of crying and bringing tears of joy. Last fall, or maybe it was spring, I'm trying to remember, we finally had our students back. They were masked, of course,
mm-hmm.
in the performance, the prism performance last spring, mm-hmm. or last fall. I can't remember which semester it happened in. And I got into that auditorium, and no, we hadn't been together ever in a really long time. And the students started playing the first piece, and I broke down crying. I just
Wow.
because I thought, oh my God, I was so happy to see them and to be able to feel that music and to hear their music. And I just, you know, I think you're right. We're much more prone to, you know, to feeling these emotions differently than we had in the past. Mm-hmm. And I liked what you said about, I think there's something to be said about looking at things and learning from them, you know, so that, mm-hmm. that you're not hardened,
mm-hmm.
that you find a different perspective and mm-hmm. how you understand the why behind things mm-hmm. and what you learned from that.
And the other thing I'm aware of, just from something you just said, is that there's something about the last 2.5 years that has taught us that exactly, that we don't always have the answers.
Right.
And that we have to live in that, I call it mystery, you know, or this liminality or something. That is really, really hard for we human beings to do.
Right. And I think it's important that we understand that's a reminder for us, and mm-hmm. to make sure that we lean into that understanding
yeah.
too. I think that's important.
Yes. We have a question from someone. Jeff asks if there are Bible verses that speak to your heart about joy.
Oh my. You know, I probably won't be able to pull one out of my pocket and quote it specifically. I go to Corinthians often. I know those mm-hmm. passages. I think the Psalms bring me a lot of joy. Mm-hmm. And I also really think about what it means to really respect and think about how we love one another.
Mm-hmm.
And particularly when you think about the difficulty in loving your enemy,
mm-hmm.
and what does that look like? And it's particularly these days when there's so much polarization mm-hmm. happening in our country.
Yeah.
How do we use love as the purpose for our conversation or understanding? I mean, we at Scholastica, I like to quote Megan Perry Spears, who often reminds us that each of us is a holy human being. You know, and if that's how you approach a person, regardless if you agree or disagree, or there might be animosity or polarization, it allows you to, again, shift your perspective.
Exactly.
Going into that conversation, right?
Right. Yeah. To know, to bring to mind the fact that God loves that person just as much as God loves me.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Exactly.
I just read a nice little quote by Abraham Lincoln today. It was, do I not destroy my enemies when I make them my friends?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
We have a comment from Sister Jane Erickson. She says, what joy to have you here among us to share your positive outlook and joy with our students and with all of us. I am very grateful for you.
Thank you. I'm humbled by that, but thank you very much.
So I'm kind of wondering, when you look, I remember when the new year came, when we switched from 2020 to 2021, and there was so much looking back and wondering and fear, and you know, the vaccines were just starting to roll out, and nobody knew what was going to be happening. We'd had a pretty volatile election, and it was a kind of a scary time. So I'm here we are moving now from 2022 to 2023, and I'm wondering what you hope for in 2023.
You know, I really, well, I would say world peace first.
World peace, yes.
I just want to tell you a funny story, because I'm still that person who, you know, at Christmas time I write to my adult children and say, you know, Santa Claus is still waiting to find out what you want for Christmas. And ever since they were little, they put world peace at the top of the list.
Did they write peace or peas?
Yeah, peace. But, you know, I, you know, that's what I wish for, frankly. I really hope that we see a more, you know, a gentler world. You know, I'm really concerned about the, I really worry a lot about the conflict, and not just the human conflict, but nature's conflict, and what we're seeing in our, and the changes in climate and the impact that's having. For instance, the Hurricane Ian, for example, that just ripped through Florida and the surrounding states. We had lots of students and friends of the college living there that we reached out to. And, you know, is it climate change? Is it this? Is it that? You know, I truly hope that we see a kinder, we continue to remember our lessons and hope for a kinder world. You know, one of the things that, you know, I was reading about too, when I was thinking about this, was, you know, it's much more joyful to give than to receive. And I noticed, speaking of the volatile, you know, environment and the election and so on, a lot more people talking about kindness, about being a kinder person, and to, and showing that kindness to others. And to me, I think that that will be very helpful. You know, talking about, you know, how do you change your perspective, or think about a shift in perspective and how you approach people, and how we can share solving problems together instead of being at each other's throats. So, you know, so I hope for a kinder world, and I hope for a world that's, you know, a little calmer than the one we're in right now. So, and only people can do that and make that happen.
And then just, no matter our sorrows, to have that deep awareness that Gibran said about knowing that joy is sleeping, right?
Right. I'll read that again, because I think it's pretty profound. And the quote here is, when he says joy and is in sorrow are not they are inseparable. Together they come, and when one sits alone with you at your board, remember the other is asleep on your bed.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Wow. Well, Barbara, this has been delightful. We're so grateful to have you over there at St. Scholastica.
It's my joy to be here.
Yes. And I want to remind everyone to watch your inboxes for the advertisement for the next, for the November Benedictine conversation that we'll be having. And wanting to thank everyone, thanking all of you out there, thanking the Sisters of St. Scholastica who support us and are inspiration every day for me, and I know you too, Barbara. So thank you to all of you, and thank you to you, Barbara. And I want to just ask you what words you'd like to leave us with, a thought or word.
Well, you know, I want to be able to honor my mother-in-law, who taught me that. She said, "Don't forget to stop and smell the roses."
Oh.
And I think about that a lot, especially when we find ourselves all busy and anxious, and, you know, one way that we can at least make that first step to remembering some of those joys is to stop and smell the roses.
Because if we do,
mindful practice.
That's wonderful. That's a wonderful practice to end with, because if we don't stop and smell the roses, then we risk not even seeing them.
Yeah, correct. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Seeing that beauty.
Barbara, thank you.
No, thank you, Don. It was really fun to be with you tonight.
Blessings to all of you. Good night.
Good night.